So I'm regrouping myself. We're going to skip things, okay? I leave you guys to this asymptotic analysis. I leave you guys to study yourself. I'm sorry. But just too many things. It's rather interesting to me. So let me talk about just now we talk about, you know, thing, the dependence on the tier, depend on the lambda fling speed on different parameters, which is kind of fun, all right? Okay, so assuming we have determined the lambda fling speed, which actually we have with the derivation which I gave to you, lambda fling speed, I have actually roughly get those relations out, okay? Square root of the reaction rate and the diffusivity, you put those numbers in, they are actually pretty good. Even if you do the detailed asymptotic analysis, they come out to be pretty close, okay? All right. So assuming we've derived those, and also you can now go to computer and solve the fling speeds. So let's just look at realistically, how does the fling speed behave? I'm so sorry. I thought the PowerPoint's all sharpened. But anyway, you guys look at the thing. So how does the fling speed depend? Right? The fling speed depend the it correlates well with the adiabatic fling temperature. Right? So if you look at your figures there, the adiabatic fling temperature goes like this. Also, the fling speed sort of also goes like this. So the most important parameter controlling the lambda fling speed is the adiabatic fling temperature, and therefore the equivalence ratio. Okay. All right. So it's kind of obvious. And also, it depends on carbon to hydrogen ratio because of heat release and all that. Now, this plot is the lambda fling speed for the different hydrocarbon fuels. All right. Let's just say this is methane, and then you go to ethane, and then I think propane is a little bit more, but they are pretty close. All right? Methane is always have a lower value. All right? Methane, it's harder to react. I think those of you who have studied chemistry, methane is harder to ignite because the breaking of the CH bond. Okay? Methane is the only hydrocarbon which doesn't have a CC bond, those kind of things. The only thing is CH bond, which is harder to break. So methane is always a little bit, methane is always a weirder hydrocarbon compared to the others. All right? I'll always remember that. Now, what's interesting is you look at the higher hydrocarbons, butane, pentane, hexane, they're all the same, close enough. All right? So there's a great similarity in the fling speeds for the hydrocarbons. All right? These are all the alkanes, of course. There are other things, oh, it's just so terrible. The dependence on the Lewis number generally is not strong for this one-dimensional case, all right? And the biggest dependence is for hydrogen flames. Hydrogen flames, the adiabatic flame temperature peaks around stoichiometric, whereas the flame speed peaks about 1.3 equivalence ratio. And that is dependent on the Lewis number because F squared goes like Lewis number, okay? So that's how it changes. Now, there's other things. Depends on the molecular structure. This is ethane, ethylene, and acetylene. Okay, C2. All right. So this is just got the CC bond. This is C double C bond. The double bond. This is the triple bond. Right? You guys all know the acetylene, ethane and ethylene and ethane. And as you see that acetylene, the highest is compared to the ethylene compared to the ethane. All right? This sort of you'll know because acetylene is very reactive. But that's not enough if you want to really understand the basics. Okay, so we got this result. You feel very happy. You say, okay, acetylene is very reactive. But when you plot this one, you're changing two parameters. Right? When you do research, you always change one parameter at a time. When you change between them, between each one of them, there are two parameters. One is the heat of reaction. Okay? They change a lot between acetylene and ethylene. The other is the double bond and triple bond, the chemistry. All right? So when it's this way, you don't know what's causing it. So again, as I said, when you do research, as much as you can, change one variable at a time. So what's been done here is that you change the oxygen concentration in such a way that the flame temperature is matched for all of them. All right? So the flame temperature is matched. So when you match the flame temperature, that means your heat release is roughly matched. So then the difference is due to the single bond, triple bond, or double bond. Then you can see that there's still acetylene, there's higher, but the difference is not that big. All right? Okay? So now, dependence on pressure. Here is what I mentioned, right? If you plot the laminar flame speed for methane air, equivalence ratio here, you can see at the half atmosphere is here. When you increase pressure, it gets smaller and smaller and smaller. That's something I just mentioned to you, right? The flame speed goes sort of inversely with pressure and the square root or something, okay? Not square, it's n. So, but flame speed is not the correct eigenvalue. It is the laminar burning rate, which is F, which will be rho minus infinity times S, okay? So it has to be weighted by the free stream density. So when you weight it by the free stream density, this guy's gonna be 20 times bigger than this guy. So then it goes into here, okay? So you plot the laminar burning flux, the higher pressure is still higher, go this way, all right? So the reason this is higher is now it's properly is due to chemistry. All right? Your higher pressure could do this. So I just want to emphasize this one. Because in the literature, a lot of frequently that's what's represented. It's okay to represent it with it, but it's just an interpretation. All right? Interpretation. Dependence on transport properties. For example, you use nitrogen air, okay, nitrogen air, or you substitute nitrogen with argon, or you substitute argon with helium. It's kind of fun, all right? Why it's kind of fun? Because when you change nitrogen with argon, what is changing predominantly? Say that again. I can say, so CP changes, right? The CP changes because then to the, how about diffusivity? How about the molecular weight? It didn't change too much. 28 and 40, it didn't change that much, okay? So CP changes. So this guy, the CP is higher, so clearly the temperature is, CP is smaller, so the flame temperature is higher, and therefore this is burning faster. Okay? All right. Now, what changes between argon and helium? CP is the same. They're more diffusive. Okay? So this is higher. So that's, you know, so all this is reasonable. You do that. Now, however, here's one. This is the laminar flame speed. Okay? As I told you, it should be the laminar burning flux, so it's F. If you do F, then actually this guy comes down with this, okay? The reason is that it's the lighter fuel, helium. When you have 80% helium, you know, in air, that it's lighter, so actually the burning is higher. So this is sort of more proper way of interpreting the result. So there are two things basically here. Clearly there's the diffusivity, but also the molecular weight, okay? All right, this we've discussed actually about the reaction order. I don't want to go more with it. I really need to go further. I want to talk about chemical structure, okay? Actually, I'm supposed to cover this in the last hour. I'm in trouble. So chemical structure, but that's important. What I've talked with you just then, even though we have chemistry, but it's really simple chemistry. I interpret everything on the basis of one step overall reaction, okay? I want to actually tell you some of the things which is might not be totally right what we said. All right? So let's see. So asymptotic stress, I can see roughly, even I didn't do the analysis. There, which I said that the structure which I analyzed, it's a broad, convective, diffusive, long, non-reactive zone, right? I have two zones. A broad, diffusive, convective, but non-reactive, and a very thin reactive zone. So it's followed by a narrow, diffusive, reactive zone at downstream end of the flame. And also, I say one step overall reaction, okay? Now, what does this one step overall reaction do, my reaction rate? It does two things. First thing, it gives me chemical activation, okay? Secondly, it gives me heat release. My heat release depends on my reaction rate, right? Correct? So actually, if you think deeper, this guy is playing two roles. Chemical activation, and also heat release when you use one step overall reaction, all right? When you have detailed reaction, different reactions do different jobs. Yeah. Also, chemical activation is thermal in nature, correct? Because it's large activation. When the temperature gets high, it's activated. That's all right? Okay, but before chapter one, we talk about all sorts of reactions, right? How reaction gets started. So let's look at the real structure. So the chemical structure, okay? Again, just sort of, even without analyzing anything, knowing what we know, day one, chemistry. Today, just then, I talk about one-step flame structure, okay? Now you draw back your day one knowledge. You challenge me. You see, what you say, some of it doesn't make sense. And I say, yes, doesn't make sense. So let's see what it doesn't make sense, okay? First of all, termination reaction is temperature insensitive. One-step reaction, everything is controlled by one-step reaction, temperature sensitive, all right? But then we know there is this funny group of reactions, which is three-body reaction, remember? Three-body reaction, which is temperature insensitive. And since it's temperature insensitive, it doesn't have to occur at the highest temperature. It can occur in the cold part of the flame, in the diffusion zone. Remember, diffusion zone, reaction zone. Very broad, low temperature diffusion, high temperature. So termination reaction can actually go here. It doesn't have to be located there, okay? So that's one thing. So reaction, you can say reaction can take place throughout the entire flame structure. So the flame structure I give you, not really right. I localize everything in this thin reaction zone, but it can go everywhere, okay? All right. Termination reaction can be highly exothermic. Why? Because termination reaction, you have two active species, they combine, so they release heat, right? So the third body takes away the heat, but whichever way it takes away the heat, so there's the heat coming out. So it's highly exothermic. So since it can occur anywhere or everywhere, so in particular in the preheat zone, in this broad zone, it can react there and it can release heat there. So you can get heat release in this preheat zone. Okay, makes sense? You don't have to have all the heat release occurring in this final zone. So also we've talked about chemical activation is through radicals produced at the downstream. That's something I mentioned before. High temperature end that diffuses back to the preheat zone. That's something I mentioned in the first day. I have the radicals, right? The initiation reactions. I say the homogeneous system initiation reaction is produced by the few oxidizer species. But in flames, you get active radicals produced here, the back diffuse and start the reaction, okay? So you would expect things would be quite different in real flame structure. Right? So let's look at that. This rather thing. So here's, I'm gonna add probably two or three slides, different things. So here I just plot the very simple thing, the oxygen oxygen profile and the hydrogen profile. Okay? Here, you know, somewhere here is the flame. Here's the flame. Here's the active reaction zone. Okay? Here's the flame. First of all, you can see that hydrogen diffusion zone is thicker than the oxygen diffusion zone. Okay? If somewhere here is where your active reaction is thicker. So which is obvious, because hydrogen is more diffusive, all right? So it's thicker. So that's okay. Now, there's something interesting here, kind of curiosity. You can see oxygen comes here, and suddenly there's a peak and then goes down, okay? So then if you look at it, you say, geez, how come I'm producing oxygen as I'm going to the flame, right? How come my oxygen increases? Now, this turns out to be totally kind of weird. Not weird, it's really just, it's a definition. Definite, because as I go down here, if the hydrogen concentration goes less, in a relative sense, oxygen concentration increases. It's a percentage-wise thing. It's really just definition. I want to show this to you. I just want to mention to you, there are all these kind of pitfalls when you try to interpret your results. If you don't think carefully, then you have cooked out all sorts of theories saying that there's some oxygen produced in my chemical reactions. So this is just straight definition, how you do that. All right, here is, I have all the arrows. Here, this is a very rich figure. Oh God, I'm so sorry, this is not clear. I swear I have a clear view. They probably uploaded some earlier version. But anyway, you guys please look at the figures. So if you look at this, I'm plotting the structure, the concentration profiles, okay, temperature. And then you can see that the whole region is very thick. Okay? Whole region here is really very thick. That's one thing. Now, it's awful. Here, that if you look at hydrogen, I really need to look at some of the figures to do that. You guys absolutely cannot see, right? This thing. How does it look? Oh, that's terrible. So, no, I think I have, I probably have uploaded the thing. So this looks good. Okay, let me just do this. Maybe I'll look at that too. I'm gonna sit down. If you guys look into this hydrogen, and this is awful. Okay, I'm gonna do it here, okay? You guys follow this. Let's see if we can do this. Otherwise, I can't even see too well here. Huh? This guy? Yeah. If you guys have the computer, then it shows very well. Yeah. So if you look at the bottom figure, that you look at the hydrogen, okay? I can only do some just rough description. You look at the hydrogen, initially it dips.
Professor Locke?
Yeah?
If you go ahead and point an arrow on the video, and then when they go back to the video online, you're looking at your reading at there, make sure you point it out slowly up there, and then
I'll
know what you're talking about.
I cannot see well here. Gee. I cannot see well here. It's just, anyway, if you see that there is, for the hydrogen in the bottom figure, the hydrogen atom concentration, there's a dip, and then it increases, right? You guys all see that. So then you can see very well what I said. Hydrogen is produced. I'm sorry, I don't want to be bothered with this. So you can see that the hydrogen atom is produced downstream of my reaction zone. And then it's produced, so that's why it's positive. But then it's consumed in the upper, in the front region of the reaction zone, okay? Why is it consumed in the front part of the reaction zone? Is because, remember I told you, the hydrogen is the one that initiates the reaction, H plus O2 going to OH plus O. All right? So that's, it really shows this. So now you look at the top part, the upper figure, then you have the, so then I produce the HO2. See that? Okay, there's HO2 times 20 and H2O2. So this is the initiation reaction, you see, which is different from what we say about the homogeneous system, that which the initiation is totally different. It's H2 plus O2, but now it's H plus O2 going to that, all right? Producing HO2, right? You see that? There's HO2, and then HO2 is followed by H2O2. Mm-hmm. So all those chemistry which we talk about in lecture one shows that. Mm-hmm. So it's also interesting, if you look at the bottom figure, if you look at the H2 and O2, which is interesting, the minimum value, the ratio is about 2 to 1, which is sort of overall conservation, right? H2O, right? H2O, right? H2 plus O2, the ratio should be 2 to 1. So that's what you have. All right, now, I have some other gems, but I just don't have it here. Okay, let's go to the next one. The next one is interesting. Next figure. Can we go to the next figure? Let me go to the next figure. Whatever, it's not terrible. So now, here is interesting. The next one, now thermostructure. Thermostructure, major, let me see. If you look at the upper figure, I have an arrow drawn from the there's a red thing, the maximum, the third bullet point, right? Maximum heat release occurs at 800 degree K. See that? I have this bottom figure going into the, there's a heat release rate. The upper figure has a heat release rate. And if you look at the maximum heat release rate, and you see there's an arrow going down, and it's pointing out at the temperature profile, correct? And you look at the temperature profile, the temperature at the maximum heat release rate is 800 degree K. Very profound result, because normally you expect the maximum heat release rate occurs at the maximum temperature, that's almost towards the end, that's 2000 degrees, right? But actually the maximum heat release rate occurs at the very upstream end of my diffusion zone, okay? Why is it occur this? Because this is H plus O2, okay? My termination reaction. The termination reaction, this is the first bullet point, major exothermic reactions, H consumption layer, this H plus O2 plus M, that gives me the heat. And I told you that H plus O2 plus M is not it's not temperature sensitive. It can go all over the place, okay? Because of the termination reaction. So in particular, it goes into the front and releases the heat, okay? And then if you can look for the fourth bullet point, says that 30% of the heat release in the H consumption layer at 1,000 degrees. Okay? So all this is contrary to what you expect from sort of a one-step overall reaction, the general concept of a reaction, a general concept of a flame. And that I want you to really remember this. It's a very sobering thought, sobering thing, that you have, again, the conventional concept, simplified concept, is that you have an upstream, very broad diffusion region in which there's no heat release, and then there's followed by a very narrow region of you know, all chemical reactions, heat release and something. But now that it says that, no, it's really, really not. There is, you know, different kind of reactions, and in particular, H plus O2 plus M, the radicals goes into the cold part of the flame structure and the recombines and releases heat. Okay? So that's really what I want to say. I'm so sorry. I have to ask them to double check the thing. If this, you know, there are several gems we covered in this part, and this is the not gem, subtle points, important points. Okay, I really would like you to remember that. I mean, a modern combustion person should know only not just the physics sort of thing, but also the chemistry. That's why chemistry really, really gets coupled. And that's even for myself, at a certain, you know, I was more from the physical side of things. Then gradually I got converted, I recognized chemistry is really important. And those are the things, they're very convincing. You have to recognize the importance of chemistry. Okay. So summary and contrast, let me again. So important reactions occur throughout the flame structure. H radical needed for initiation at the leading edge is produced in the downstream and back diffuses. Okay? Maximum heat release occurs at the front of the active reaction zone. Substantially heat evolved in the moderately low temperature region of the flame. So all these things, please remember. Okay, let's talk about limit phenomena. So I just get, sorry about it. I better fix this because when I go to China to talk, the screen will be even bigger. There's nothing we show. I think I have a sharper versions. I think it's downloaded wrong. Maybe not. Okay, limit phenomena. Limit phenomena, we're talking about, okay, forget about what I said there now. Not forget, just, you know, put aside. That's an idealized case, of course. Planar flame and all that. Of course, we still try to, it's still important because we're still measuring the laminar flame speeds and which gives us the chemistry and all that. Now, realistic flames are subjected, as I said at the beginning of today, to two major classes of effects, okay? Two major classes. One is heat loss or heat gain. So say becomes non-adiabatic, okay? See what happens. Especially when there's loss, it could extinguish, right? So what happened? So that's one. The other is the aerodynamics, right? So I'll try to cover all of them. I will be skipping now, I'm sorry. Concepts of ignition and extinction. So how do we think about ignition? All right? There are different ways of looking at it. One is thermal runaway. Okay? Thermal runaway is basically easy. I have a mixture here. I heat it up a little bit. I just heat it up a little bit. Then the chemical reaction starts, some chemical reaction. And it gives me more heat, makes it hotter, goes even faster. All right? Since everything is exponential, in terms of reaction, then it can run away. All right? From that point of view. All right? So it can run away. Then you ask me the question, then why everything would run away? This guy can sit here, it can run away. I mean, the fabrics, right? It has some reaction going on there. Maybe, right? It'll release some heat. So what is stopping it from running away is this loss. When it's generating heat a little bit, but it's also loss. Okay, convert it out. Right? Otherwise, you raise the any mixture, you raise the temperature by 1 degree K, it's gonna run away. All right, if you don't have a loss. Anything going one way, it's gonna go. So, all right. Now, there's also radical runaway, which we discussed the first day. Branching reactions, right? I have one radical into two go to four go to 16, whatever, it runs away. Right? So that's another one, right? Okay, these are just the concepts. This unsteady analysis, you can look at the problem, you see, okay, whether you follow the time and see whether it'll go away, that's one thing. Another way to look into ignition is what's called a steady S-curve analysis, which I will introduce to you. Basically, you ask yourself the question, given a situation, a steady state situation, would I get a steady state situation? With given amount of loss and the transport and heat, would such a flame exist? If the flame would exist, okay, it's possible to exist. But there are situations in which the flame would not exist because inherently the flame cannot. When the flame is there, it's losing heat, all right? Even though it tries to burn, but if I put something really cold to it, it's gonna kill the flame, all right? So steadily, I will not have a flame. So you analyze a steady state situation and ask the question, do I have a flame? Do I not have a flame? And then that gives you the boundaries in which it will. All right. So we'll do that. Ultimately, I want you to think in mind in terms of extinction. Those are, again, the things which I have sort of become wiser and wiser, and then to try to look at things, you know, as simple a manner as possible. Ultimately, when you talk about extinction, you are talking about system adiabaticities. Okay, it sounds obvious. You have to, when you want to see how you can extinguish a flame, how things can go, you always look at where the energy is lost, or the radicals is lost. Radicals is chemical energy, all right? A lot of times it's hard to see, actually, all right? But invariably, you need to have some kind of loss mechanism for my system to become non-adiabatic, to extinguish. Mm-hmm. So, okay. Now, the one way to look into this thing is a principle of Wester reactor. Basically, what you see is that I have a system in which it's reacting, giving me reaction rate, okay, like this. The reaction, as temperature, this temperature, this reactivity, the reaction rate increases, and then when it's when the reactants are depleted, it comes down. And then there's always some loss. And the loss, the behavior is more like linear. All right? Then you can see that there are situations in which, for example, when it goes here, that under very low regimes, that you can get a very sort of, so basically they balance each other. You have reaction, you have heat loss. And then they balance each other, then there could be situations in which it is reacting very weakly at low temperature, or it can be reacting very very actively at the high temperature region. This is the reaction profile at here. Or it can actually have several possibilities. It can go here, it can go here, it can go in the middle. Okay, so those are all possible solutions. Mm-hmm. So what you end up with is so everything depends on your loss, whether you get ignition or you get ignition or extinction or steady burning. It all depends on the heat transfer of a problem. So if you were to plot, say, a certain typical maximum temperature as a function of Damkolo number, I've told you is typically of, you know, reaction time, flow, diffusion time versus reaction time, you typically get what's called an S curve. It's an absolutely important thing. It's an S curve here. All right. So what it says is that as you increase your Damkolo number, basically you're increasing the reactivity, all right? Then in your flow regime, for example, you have a maximum reaction temperature or something, then gradually it'll increase the temperature, but very slowly, okay? Very slowly. But up to a certain point, it cannot increase by itself anymore. Then it suddenly jumps, okay? It jumps to this branch. This is an intensely burning branch. Mm. So what it means is that if you try to ignite it, gradually move here, it'll maintain a very, you know, basically non-reactive, weakly reactive case. At a certain point, fit, it goes into here. All right, then that's ignition state. And if you are burning it very strongly, if it somehow induces some kind of loss mechanism, then it'll gradually go to here, then it suddenly extinguishes. All right? So that's frequently how you can analyze the system, whether it'll ignite, it'll extinguish. It goes into here. All right? And there are cases in which, you know, it's a hysteresis problem. You have to overshoot this one to go to the ignition state here. Then you have to undershoot it to go to extinction. So basically what it is, when a flame which is, it's harder to ignite, it's not easy to ignite. You have to go to a higher Damkolo number. That means it's more reactive for it to ignite. But once it ignites, it doesn't want to extinguish. You have to push it harder to go back to here to do it. Okay? So you'll be seeing quite a lot, if you study combustion, you'll be seeing quite a lot of this kind of S-curves. So that's basically what it is. Now, what I want to do is I want to very quickly in view of the time, derive a very simple problem of extinction. All right. So what I analyze is the, I'll just verbally tell you what I analyze. We have studied this one-dimensional frame, which I say is adiabatic. Okay, everything goes. Now I say that there's heat loss from my frame. Okay, what's the heat loss? All sorts of heat loss. I can put a needle there and then take away the heat. Or more realistically, there's radiation. Temperature goes higher, there's heat loss to it. Okay, so therefore the profiles, without heat loss, the temperature is this, okay? With heat loss, it goes into here. You know, the temperature decreases and eventually decreases here. So, and when the loss is substantial, of course, you need to quantify what's mean by substantial, but when it's substantial, if the temperature here, normally without heat loss, there's adiabatic frame temperature, right? Which I've shown you. With heat loss, there's some lower temperature here. So when there is just sort of what's called order epsilon loss, small loss, 5% loss, then the frame cannot sustain itself. Then it dies. Then the frame dies with this. So what I want to briefly, just roughly indicate to you how this can happen. All right? How this can happen is, let me just talk about the physics. If I have a loss here, then obviously it'll reduce the burning rate. I'm strictly just talking physics now. Don't even look at the formula. If I have some loss here, I'll reduce the burning rate. If I reduce the burning rate, the flame gets thicker. Okay? If you look at the formula which I derived. Right? If it's propagating very fast, it's very thin. Propagates slow, there's more time to diffuse, so it's thicker. So the physics is following. If I have some loss, propagates slower, and the flame gets thicker. When it gets thicker, it gets more loss, right? There's more volume for it to lose heat. Right? So it gets thicker, loses more, it propagates even slower, then it gets even thicker, then it's losing more. So it's a cycle, all right? And then at a certain point, it just go out. So that's all. It's a very simple concept. Right? Is this clear? You have a loss, the frame gets thicker, You have a loss, the frame propagates slower, it gets thicker. It gets thicker, it loses more heat, goes slower, more heat. And then there's exponential, right? Reaction rate is exponential. So exponential feedback eventually dies. Okay? That's all I was trying to, I'm trying to demonstrate this to you guys. So you guys can sort of see what I have. This is, for example, the loss mechanism. The loss is integral of, the total amount loss is the loss coefficient integrated over the distance. So basically it's the thickness of the flame times the loss. Thickness of flame is lambda over Cp divided by F, right? Which we just derived. So therefore, you can easily see if I loss, then I reduce the F, then I have basically, no, if I, whatever, if I have loss, I reduce the F, yeah, then I have basically more loss that feeds back into here. Now, so if I do the same derivation as before, I want to show you something rather interesting. Remember before we got the F square, remember? I have the F square going like this expression at the beginning of the class, right? F goes like square root lambda of CPW. That's what I have, all right? So now I have a loss. When I have a loss, my temperature changes due to the loss, all right? So when I put everything in, just crank out algebra, straight, just everything's still algebra, then I end up a formula like this. So this is my frame propagation burning flux. Before it's F0 without loss. Now there's some loss, okay? So I end up with this formula. I want to show you this formula. This F squared log F squared going to minus L. Okay, L is the loss. F is the frame speed versus my adiabatic frame speed. So it's reference to that, all right? So this is a powerful and very general expression, right? It basically indicates how a flame gets extinguished by any kind, by many kind of factors. If I were to plot this guy versus L versus the loss, you end up with a function like this. Okay, I want you guys to pay attention to it now, like this. So what does it mean? That means if there's no loss, F is 1, okay? This is an adiabatic case. When there is loss, go this way, the frame speed decreases, okay? When there's loss, follow this way. Decreases, 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 back, come to here, drops down, extinction. Okay? So there's this extinction point. This is not a stable branch, so don't worry about it. So this curve, again, this result, it's a very powerful result. It basically indicates how much loss a flame can sustain before it extinguishes. Okay? How many? And then, even more significant, I want you guys to, again, appreciate the sort of analyticity, okay? It's such a simple formula. Such a simple form. It's just got one parameter, just a loss parameter. Later I'll show you, there's other processes. Everything just boils down to something like that. Okay? Remember, even your sleep tonight, okay? F squared log F squared equal to minus L. Okay? Please. What is this? Single parameter, right? So then I can derive the turning point, this point. The turning point is just take the derivative of this guy by this guy. Everybody, you can close your eyes and do it. Huh? So this point, the loss is e to the minus 1. It's a number, okay? 0.6 something. Fe is, no, this Fe is 0, yeah. It's e to the minus half. So what it means is that in this non-dimensional parameter, LE, you can go back to see the definitions for this one, that if you can impart a loss by the amount of this guy, and this guy will extinguish when the frame speed is this. This is about 0.6. So put it another way, when you look at certain flame, you measure its burning rate. When it's go to about 60% of the adiabatic flame speed, that's so important, adiabatic flame speed. When it goes to about 60%, goes to 50%, it'll go. Okay? It cannot sustain it. It will go with this. So this, you know, for anything, I would want you guys to remember this. And this has been, people have found it, actually. You can do computation studies, okay? You can do computation study allowing for radiation transfer, putting your detailed chemistry, methane, whatever, hydrogen, whatever. You can see, I can just give you some example. I think this is what, methane case, probably. You can see how it extinguishes this point. And then it goes, it's so remarkable. The turning point goes like e to the minus half, okay? For real case, these are the real case. And more needs to be studied, this thing. If you guys are curious, you know how to run this kind of programs, you can do it. But you need to put in radiative heat loss to do this, all right? Extinction. There's another concept I don't want to bother you. There's what's called limit temperature. Let me just mention, throughout, for almost 100 years, it's in the last century in this time, there's an observation of what's called the limit temperature. Hydrocarbon flames, if you can reduce the temperature below this guy, it won't burn. 1450, around this value, huh? 1450. So it's called the limit temperature. You guys can see some of the older textbooks and older things. And it seems to, some recent studies seem to indeed sure when you have a flame with the radiative heat loss and all that, it'll die at 1450. That's called the limit temperature concept. All right? So there's all these fairly interesting things. Let me see, what's the time we still have? Do I need to talk about flame stabilization? You guys know this? This is a kind of conventional. Okay, let me just briefly talk. Those are actually important concepts. So I've been talking about extinction problem, okay, quickly. This is stabilization, flame stabilization. So flame stabilization, if you think it's a Bunsen, you guys all know, Bunsen flame sits on top of this, right? Why does the flame sit on top of it? Even the flow here is fairly high. The flow here is very high speed. It's higher than the laminar flame speed, but the flame doesn't get blown away. It sits over the rim. What's happening is that, you know, here's the gas flow, here's the rim. So when you have a flame here, flame is losing heat to the rim, so the flame speed here is low, and the flame speed here is high. So the gas, you know, the flame and the gas, and the flame and the gas will want to maintain a balance, dynamic balance. So if the flame speed here is low, because of heat loss, is going to push it away until there's some balance occurring. And if it's pushed too much away, then it's going to come back. So it has to maintain this steady state somewhere here. So again, it's a totally different problem I'm talking about. Flame stabilization is a dynamic balance, okay? Dynamic balance at the rim, whatever you want to call it, this flame stabilization, anchoring, things, it's the same thing. Basically, you just need to have one point at the base of the rim for the flame to sit, okay? Anchor, just one point. Flame speed and the flame speed and flow speed will balance. Mm-hmm. And the fact that the flame speed can change is due to heat loss to the rim. So therefore, if you blow at this hotter, if throughout the flame, count all the flame regions, it cannot sustain a balance, then the flame gets blown off, it's called, go away. All right? So the whole idea of flame stabilization is a dynamic balance between flame speed and flow speed. All right? One point of caution, the flame gets blown off. It has nothing to do with extinction. Again, a lot of people get confused. The flame gets blown off, this flame extinguishes. It's not extinction, it's not extinguished. It's just blown off. Lack of dynamic balance for it to go, okay? The other case we study is indeed extinction. Reaction rate goes out, okay, with this. So this is the stabilization mechanism. Now, what's interesting is the next one I want to mention, because this one, you need a flame speed for it to achieve balance, okay? So therefore, you can, then obviously, this is a premixed gas, it's got a flame speed here. So you can evaluate the flame speed, okay? That's how you do. Then for the longest time, people were confused. If this is fine, but what happens if I don't have premixed gas? Just like a Bunsen flame. I have a pure gas, right? Pure fuel gas, methane coming out. And the air is outside, okay? So it's a diffusion flame, correct? It's a diffusion flame. It's not a premix flame. Because my argument here is based on the fact that this is premix here. So you have a premix flame, you have a flame speed. Diffusion flame, I have no flame speed, all right? But you still get stabilized. I mean, in your chemistry lab, you know that. Your Bunsen flame, you close the intake port, right? You know, the bottom port, you close it, you still get a flame. You still get a flame here. And that's a diffusion flame, correct? That's a diffusion. So how can that flame get stabilized? It doesn't have a flame speed, okay? So the explanation, not the explanation, that's what's really happening, is the following. It's what you have here is you have the fuel coming here, you have the air here. Here is the stabilization region, okay? But there's a dead region here. There's a dead region here. And this is the region where the fuel and the air, the fuel will come here, air will come here, they will mix. They will mix in this dead region. And when they mix, they become a premixture. When they become a premixture, the flame segment for this guy is a premix flame. This is a blow up picture. This is this one, okay? So this flame is what's called a triple flame. On this side, it's a premix flame. So this side is a fuel rich flame. This side is a fuel lean flame, right? This got more fuel, this got more air, fuel lean, fuel rich. But nevertheless, it's a premix flame. And the middle here is a diffusion flame. It's a very interesting structure, which has been observed. So basically, fuel-rich flame will give you extra fuel, fueling flame will give you extra oxygen, and they form a diffusion flame. So the whole flame structure, this is still diffusion flame, non-premix flame, except at the bottom. The bottom has this triple flame structure, which the leading edge is a premix flame, with changing from rich to lean, okay? And so it is through this premix flame that the flame gets stabilized. And the stabilization point is this point, the stoichiometric point, when it goes. All right? So that's the concept of flame stabilization, this premix and diffusion. And again, there's experimental results demonstrating this. So, okay. So that's basically what this is. What are we doing? Another hour, right? Okay, let's take one more break.